Paul Zeitz, who's one of our visiting mathematicians, is also going to be introducing tonight's speaker. And just to tell you a little bit about Paul, he has been a longtime supporter and friend of this museum since before it even opened. I first got wind of Paul when we sent one of our traveling exhibits to a museum in Berkeley, California, and someone told me there was this guy coming in and running programs with our exhibit, and we sent a good guy, except we hadn't sent anyone, and it was Paul. And he just loved our exhibit so much that, and he loved the math of the exhibit and talking to the public about it, that he started interacting with the public around the exhibit and became really a good friend to the museum. He also happens to be one of the founders of the Proof School, which is a math school out in the Berkeley area, one of the founders of the Bay Area Math Circle. He's an author, and he's also a former International Math Olympiad contestant, as well as now a coach, as well as the person who's organizing the IMO that will be here in this country, maybe in Washington, D.C., in 2 years? Okay, I got that right. And so Paul's a great guy, and we're really delighted to have both Peter and Paul with us for the year. And with that, I hope you'll join me in welcoming, yeah, I know, we don't have Mary. If anybody knows a female mathematician named Mary who'd like to be here for the year, we'd love to have her, because that would just be great. But in the meantime, Paul is going to introduce tonight's speaker, who is unfortunately not named Mary, but she's nevertheless going to give a great talk. So let me turn it over to Paul.
Thank you very much. So I'm here to introduce Cornelia Van Cott, and she happens to be my colleague. In fact, she's sort of my boss. She's the department chair at the University of San Francisco, where we both work. And I've known her for more than 10 years. We hired her 11 years ago. And so let me tell you a little bit about her. She is from Indiana. She grew up in Indiana. She went to college in Illinois, but that was too far from Indiana, so she went back to Indiana for grad school, where she studied topology and became a knot theorist. And she does very exciting research. Recently, she's been discovering some connections between knot theory and number theory. We hired her at the University of San Francisco, and now she's our department head. Now, she also plays the church organ for fun, and like anyone from Indiana, she is a very, very serious basketball fan. So these are just sort of facts, and they don't really tell you anything about what Cornelia is like. And so something that's important about math that many people don't understand, but maybe you do if you come to the museum, is that mathematics is a social endeavor. And in fact, Ravi Vakil, who was a speaker here 2 years ago, he told me about 12 years ago that he reminded me that mathematics is the most social of the sciences. And the reason for that is because math is really difficult. And so people need to work together in order to penetrate mathematical mysteries. So 11 years ago, when we were interviewing Cornelia for a job at the University of San Francisco, one thing she told us was that she had organized a conference for young topologists. And she boasted, she said, "I know all the young topologists." And she meant that literally. A year later, after we had hired her, she was on a hiring committee with us, and we were at a convention in Washington, D.C., and I found that it was impossible to walk more than 10 feet with her because somebody would run up to her and hug her. And so every 15 seconds, hug. It was like being with a celebrity. And the reason I'm telling you this is to remind you that what makes mathematics important is not the math itself, but the ability to share it and to communicate it with others. And that's why I'm really grateful that Cornelia is my colleague, and that's why I'm thrilled that you're going to experience some of the mathematics that she wants to share with you tonight. So thank you.
All right, thank you very much for the kind introduction. And thank you all for coming on Wednesday night to come hear more about math. And our topic today is pi. And if you read the title, pi sometimes equals 4, you should feel that that's a little bit of mathematical blasphemy, right? Because if you may have forgotten a lot of things from high school math, but But one thing that usually remains is people remember that pi is 3.14 or something like this. And your feelings of shock are reminiscent of this scene from The Simpsons, which I'd love for us all to recall or hear about for the first time if you haven't seen it. There's a scene where Professor Frink is trying to get this room full of scientists to quiet down, and they're all chatting amongst themselves. No one's paying attention to him, and he's saying, order, order, scientists, I need you to give me some order. No one listens, so finally he raises his voice and shouts out. Does anyone know what he shouts out? Pi is exactly 3. And immediately the crowd gasps and falls silent. So you have Professor Frink saying pi is exactly 3. You have me saying pi is sometimes equal to 4. And at the end of this talk, you'll be able to evaluate any such statement. All right, but let's first push away these blasphemous statements. No more of that. Let's go back to simple beginnings. How was pi originally defined? And what we all know and love from high school math. We know that pi is 3.14, and then it just goes on and on forever. Pi is one of those mysterious, irrational numbers. The decimal digits never end, and they never become periodic. So you can see that the digits are a seeming complete jumble. All right, and even if you've left high school and you aren't really connected with math anymore, pi still comes up in your daily life maybe once a year, because there's this new trend to celebrate Pi Day on March 14th, right? So maybe even once a year you get reminded of this value. But one of the things that Americans can do is they start to celebrate things or get into trends, and they forget the reason why they were interested in these things in the first place. For example, Labor Day, do we still remember, or are we just happy for a 3-day weekend? Yeah? But we don't want that to happen to Pi Day, may it never be, right? So we need to remember, why is this number unique? What makes it special? Why aren't we celebrating, say, 2.14159? Besides the fact that maybe that would mean we have to celebrate on Valentine's Day, and that's already taken. Okay, but there is something really beautiful and mysterious about this number. Let's recall what it is. It all comes from circles. So you draw a circle, and you measure two things about the circle. Measure its circumference and its diameter. Take those two numbers, and the wonderful thing is that it doesn't matter what circle you choose, small or large, this ratio will be the same. It'll be that very mysterious, irrational number, pi. That's where the first place where you notice, you know, this pi number, it's unique. It shows up as this ratio no matter what circle I draw. So you might have maybe a handful of these digits memorized yourself, but you know, these digits, they just go on and on with no rhyme or reason, and it's a fair question for you to ask. How do mathematicians know that, like, these digits are all correct? And if I just left the room and said, you guys need to give me the next digit, what would you do to find that next digit? So I'm going to tell you how mathematicians go about finding the digits of pi, just to give you a basic idea. So it's not through measuring circles extra carefully anymore. That was how it was done originally through antiquity, and you measure very carefully, measure across with very clever things. But now we don't do this. We get at pi through a different direction. We have formulas, clever formulas for pi, and they help us get an estimate. Let me give you one such clever formula to start. So we want to first take all the odd integers, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, and the dot, dot, dot means just keep them on coming. It's an infinite list of odd integers. And now take the reciprocals of all those odd integers. That means put them all in the denominator of a fraction. Okay. Next step is we're going to turn this into a big, long addition problem and make plus, minus every other number. So there we go. So this is an infinite addition problem. That's a very formidable thing, but we'll just skip right over that for now. And we'll take that whole sum and multiply it by 4. And what do you get when you do that? You get pi. So this is a clever formula for pi. It has some concerning things, that this is an infinite sum. But it's actually very famous. It's called Leibniz's formula. And we can use this to get an estimate on pi. So you can't in human time add up all these numbers in this parentheses. There's infinitely many of them. But maybe you could just add up the first 100 numbers, multiply by 4, and you get an estimate for pi. And if you want to improve on that, maybe add up the first 200 numbers, multiply by 4, get a better estimate for pi. So in this way, we get closer and closer and figure out the digits of pi. But unfortunately, this isn't quite as useful as you might think. So to get 10 decimal digits of pi, you must add up the first 5 billion terms. So this formula, though it looks very friendly in some sense, it's not too complicated, it doesn't give you a lot of bang for your buck. You have to add up 5 billion terms to get the first 10 decimal digits. There's too much more to go. Sorry. So let me show you. We don't use this today. We use something else. It's the Chudnovsky formula. It was discovered by these two brothers. They're the Chudnovsky brothers. They live here in New York City, and they immigrated from the Ukraine. And here's their formula, and it's going to look really scary compared to the previous one. So here it is. Looks really messy. But if you can just parse it just a tad, it's really just a big fraction, right? And in the numerator, we have this number. And in the denominator, we have an infinite sum, just like on the previous equation. We're supposed to add up an infinite number of terms. If you're not familiar with this notation, that's what it represents. You're supposed to add up an infinite number of terms. And it works like dynamite compared to Leibniz's formula. After summing just two terms, you already have more than 10 digits of pi. Okay, the Leibniz's formula, you had to do billions of terms. Here, just two terms. And with each further term, you increase the accuracy by 14 digits on average. So you're just galloping through, getting more and more digits of accuracy with each further term that you add in this infinite sum. All right, so this is a big improvement. And before we move on, I just want to mention that these two brothers have a really interesting life story. And it was written up in The New Yorker called The Mountains of Pi. Because they discovered that formula, and then they decided to build a supercomputer in their Manhattan apartment to compute these digits of pi. And they just made it through mail order parts. They said that they needed to give acknowledgments to Home Depot for all their help in making their supercomputer. The story is very interesting. So on your subway ride home, you should look it up and enjoy reading their interesting lives. But I also want to highlight that this is the formula that's used today. It was discovered in the late 1980s. But just this year, this is a picture of Emma Owao. She's a Google employee. And she used the Chudnovsky formula to compute the first 31 trillion digits of pi and made the world record, of course. And she didn't just use this formula. She also used Google Cloud, which provided a lot of data storage. So the two things together brought the ability to get that far into the decimal digits of pi. All right, now I want to go back and talk about something that I kind of glossed over before, and that is something about circles. So when you read those instructions there at the top of the screen, it says you're supposed to draw a circle of radius 3 centered at the origin. And most of you have great muscle memory and memory from how things should work, and you could draw this shape no problem. But what I want to highlight that maybe you don't think about because you've done it so much is that the definition of circle depends on how you describe distance. So, for example, this point up here, he's part of the circle. Why? Because the distance from the origin up to this point is 3. So he gets to be part of the circle. Next, this point is part of the circle because the distance between the origin and that point is also 3. And so really, it's a point-by-point discovery process to say who gets to be in the circle. And you're measuring distance from the origin to the point by a straight line. And eventually you realize, oh, I see, there are all these points, and they're all part of the circle. But I just want to highlight that the definition of a circle depends on finding all the points whose distance from the origin is a particular value. Now, I'd like to remind you of a good principle for being a mathematician is that you should have a rebellious edge. If someone tells you you should do something this way, this is the rule in math, you should always say, what happens if I break the rule? It should just be part of how you think. It sounds bad, but when you do that, one of two things will happen. Either you'll realize, oh, whoops, there was a good reason for that rule, and you'll go back and you'll be a stronger mathematician because of it, because you'll understand the reasons why you're doing things. Or another possibility is you'll discover something new. All right, so we're going to try the same sort of thing here. I told you something just now, and probably everyone swallowed it, hook, line, and sinker, and I'm going to help you develop that rebellious edge. The thing I said is that the distance between two points is measured by a straight line between them. And you probably all feel like that's a great idea, right? And you probably even remember the formula for the distance between two points, the distance formula. This is a nice choice. It's called the Euclidean distance. And it's a good choice if you're a crow, because it's like as the crow flies, or if you own a helicopter. But there are lots of other ways to measure distance. Let's choose one and see what happens. So away it goes. Let's find a different distance function. So the most common alternative is something called taxicab distance. So you imagine that there's a car at point P, and he needs to get up to point Q. And he can't just drive roughshod over people's backyards and pools. No, he needs to stay on the road. And by staying on the road in this context, I mean the car can only drive on horizontal and vertical lines. So to get from P to Q, it travels over and up. Okay, so it's a new way of getting from P to Q, not by a straight line, but by traveling over and up. Taxicab distance. We can come up with the formula for this. How far did the taxicab drive horizontally? Well, it's just a difference in x values. And how far did the taxicab drive vertically? Difference in y values. Add those two together and you get the total distance traveled. This is also called the Manhattan metric because it models driving around in Manhattan to a point. All right, so let's adopt this. Like, probably none of us like the square root in the old distance function, right? It always caused numbers to come out strange. This has no square root. We're liking this a lot. So let's choose this as our distance function and see what happens. The first thing that changes is the shape of circles. So let's consider, what would it look like to draw a circle of radius 3 about the origin with taxicab distance? All right. So you got to imagine putting that little taxicab driver right at the origin. He can only drive a distance 3. Where are the places he can end up? Well, he could drive straight a distance 3, so there's one point on the circle. We could go vertically. And there's another point on the circle. And he could travel over 1, up 2, there's another point, or over 2, up 1, there's another point on the circle, and so on. And you don't have to just go integer values, you can do anything. So I could go over 1/2, up 2.5, and there's another point on the circle. And you can see what it's tracing out here. We're going to end up with this entire diagonal line of points. Are points on the circle. And similarly, if I let the driver drive to the left or downward, we'd trace out this shape here. Okay, so that's a circle in taxicab distance. All right, so I'm considering, can I figure out the circumference and the diameter of these and compute that. So let's first reduce down to the unit taxicab distance, unit taxicab circle. So its radius is 1. And consider, what's the circumference divided by diameter here? Now, there's a lot of wrong things that might seem really right now. There's some very tempting things you could say about how long these diagonal line segments are. For example, I expect for many of us, it's tempting to say that the length of this diagonal line is the square root of 2. Why is that tempting? Because what do you see right here? A right triangle. And you can use the Pythagorean theorem. So the length here is the square root of 2. But that's if you're going as the crow flies, right? But we are not doing that anymore. We threw that away, and we have a new distance function. So you have to imagine the taxicab driver trying to travel along this line. All right, so that should make things seem a little shaky right now. So here's what I'm going to do. We're going to go back to Euclidean world and figure out how did we do circumference there, and then we'll come right back here and apply the same method here. So back in the Euclidean world, when we had these circles, that feels more normal, right? How did we find circumference here? Well, there was something tricky about this situation because this shape is nice and curvy, and we are trying to measure distance with a straight line, so there's some dissonance. How do you take your straight ruler and measure the distance around a curvy shape? So this is a problem that mathematicians have been studying throughout hundreds of years, and here's how they approach it. You start out with a circle, and you can inscribe in it polygons. And you notice as you add more and more polygons, the perimeter of these polygons is getting very close to the circumference of the circle. And the perimeter of the polygons is something that you could all compute because they have nice straight line edges. Okay? So through computing the perimeter of these polygons, we can get an approximation for the circumference of the circle. Okay? So the short tagline here is that we approximated this curvy shape with straight lines. All right, take that thought, and let's apply it to our taxicab world. We no longer have a curvy shape for circles, but we have a different problem. Now the circles have diagonal lines, and we're supposed to be measuring distance with horizontal and vertical lines. So we still have a rub, something that doesn't quite work out. But we'll apply the same principle. We'll try to approximate this diagonal line with horizontal and vertical lines. So let's zoom in on that first quadrant. Just zoom in on that. There's our diagonal line. We put our taxicab driver there. We'd like him to travel in a path that approximates the diagonal line with his usual horizontal and vertical lines. Here's a very rough approximation. The taxicab driver can drive up and over. But we can do better than this. Let's make it a little better. There's up and over with two stair steps. And we can keep improving, allowing more and more stair steps. There's four. We can keep doing better. We can keep doing better. So do you see how this is the same kind of thing as the polygons inside the Euclidean circle? We're putting more and more stair steps along this diagonal line. All right, and the principle is that the length of the stair steps, the distance that the taxicab driver has to drive to get to the top, is going to be approximating the taxicab length of the diagonal line. But in this case, something very beautiful happens, and that is, you might say, well, the distance that the taxicab driver drives depends on the number of steps. Like, what if there were 1,000 steps? Or what if there were 2,000 steps? That might seem true, but actually it doesn't matter. If there's 4 steps or if there's 1,000 steps, if the taxicab driver drives along those steps, he will always travel the same distance. Can anyone contribute what that distance will be? Really loud? 2, thank you, yes. I'll show you why that's true if you just have 4 steps, and it will work for any number. So here's 4 steps. How can I see that this driver will drive a distance of 2 if he drives on those stairs? You can see that all the up parts of the stairs, if I slide them over, they're a total distance up of 1. His vertical distance traveled is 1. And all the horizontal parts where he traveled, they can all add up to a total horizontal distance of 1. So he travels a total vertical distance of 1, horizontal distance of 1, a total of 2. And if he had 100 stair steps, the picture would have looked exactly the same. It just would have maybe taken 3 hours to create, right? All right, so that's great. We just decided that the taxicab distance of this line is 2, and we can copy it around because these are all the same, just symmetric. And now we're to the point of the talk where everyone can contribute. Everyone, even if you feel like you weren't sure about it. I think that now you can tell me, what's the circumference of a taxicab unit circle? If he traveled all the way around, how far would he travel? Say it loud. 8, thank you. And then if the taxicab driver had to drive across the circle diameter, how far would he travel? 2. All right, let's plug these numbers in. 8 over 2 equals 4. So that's why we say that the value of pi, when we choose taxicab distance, is equal to 4. Okay, so you see that domino effect of changes? We decided to make that change in our distance function. That changed how our circles looked, and now it's changing the value of pi to 4. All right, so the emotions you feel right now may be mixed, because pi had been this mysterious number, right? There's nothing mysterious about 4. The old pi had infinitely many digits. 4 is an integer, right? So you feel it's not quite as mysterious as before, not quite as interesting maybe. But in fact, you should consider the flip side, which is, you know what? I changed my distance function and circles turned into these diamond shapes. What other shapes are possible? Like, choose your favorite shape you'd like to show up as a circle, and we'll find out if it's possible. And then, I mean, pi just ended up being 4 2 minutes ago. What other numbers could show up? Pick your favorite number if I just change the distance function again. And the beautiful thing is that mathematicians can answer this whole question fully. And by the end of this talk, you will know this whole answer fully. But before I reveal the answer, I think it's important that we realize that not everything works out quite like a charm. Some things are difficult. So I'm going to make us do something difficult first. Maybe not difficult, but maybe it doesn't work out how you thought. So here's something fun. We're going to measure distance differently. We're going to measure using discrete metric. So forget about Euclidean distance, forget about taxicab. We'll do discrete metric. And I nicknamed this also the teleportation metric. So here's the story to help you get to the formula. Let's say I would prefer to be in London right now. I can just snap my finger and teleport and be in London. Or if I'd like to be sitting on the front row over here, I can snap my finger and be there. Or if I'd like to remain here and keep on giving this talk, I don't have to snap my fingers at all. So what's the analogy here with distance? If you have 2 points, how far apart are they? Well, the distance is 1. So you can just snap fingers and teleport from one point to another, even if they're really far away or really close. All of their distances are 1, because 1 snap will get you there. And if you have a point to itself, how far is a point from itself? 0, because it doesn't need to snap the fingers. I hope that makes sense. And here's a formula that just says what I just said. The distance between 2 points is either 1 or 0. Those are the only choices. It's 1 if the 2 points are different. It's 0 if the points are the same. All right, so I'd like for each of you to think for yourself, what do circles look like here? So consider, what would a circle centered at the origin of radius 1 look like? And what would a circle centered at the origin of radius 3 look like? And there's the formula. And I'd love it if you could get your graph paper out and sketch what you think it looks like in both cases. Show your neighbor, too, so that you can have a little bit of conversation about it. I'll give you about 2 minutes to try it out. And if you're confused or have a question, raise your hand and I'll come help you. All right, let's pool all of our discussions together and see what we have. So in this picture, you need to find all the points whose distance from here is 1. So what do we need to shade in? Everybody is a distance 1, right? This point is a distance 1, this point, this point, this point. Is there anyone who's not a distance 1 from the origin? Yeah? Say again? The origin itself, he's a distance 0. So we just need to shade in everything except for the origin. How does it work over here? I need to shade in all the points who are a distance 3 from the origin. So is this point, how far is he from the origin? Is he a distance 3? No, he's a distance 1. Okay. So are there any points I need to shade in? The point itself, how far is the point from himself? 0, right? He's not 3. So let's see.
It's a donut.
Well, I would actually say that there are no points. You can't name for me any point who when I say, how far is he from this, you say 3. Because if you tell me, oh, this point is part of the circle, I say, oh, but his distance is 1, not 3.
No, I mean, outside, like, mm-hmm. like it's right around.
Yeah, no, actually, there's no points. Like, even if you took something way out here, how far is he from here?
1.
Still 1, yeah, but that's, it's kind of shocking, right? It's like not the answer you thought you were supposed to have. So on the left, we color in everything except the origin, and this one is awkwardly empty. There's nothing to color in. It's like a trick question, right? Like you're looking for something to color in, but there's nothing. Okay, so just like before, let's carry on like soldiers. What's the circumference divided by diameter in either of these cases? So if you're a normal human being, you feel like this is not something you can think about. It seems undefined. So, and you're right. This didn't work out nearly as well as the taxicab one did, right? The taxicab, we worked and we succeeded. This one, we worked and we are going to give up because we realize this isn't the type of distance function we're interested in. Okay, so let's switch it up. Now let's try the post office distance or post office metric. I'm going to tell you the analogy here and then you'll consider what circles look like. So let's say I need to send you a birthday card. If I'm sending you a birthday card, even if I live right next door to you, what's the path of that birthday card? It doesn't go right next door. It goes all the way to the post office and then comes back to you. So we use that analogy. It doesn't work perfectly, but use that analogy to understand this formula for distance in post office metric. It goes like this. To get from P to Q, imagine it like a letter, can't go directly from P to Q, so where's it gonna go first? Where's the post office, do you anticipate? The post office is at the origin. And so the letter goes directly to the post office. That's the one place where it doesn't quite follow the analogy, because it's like the post office has a helicopter or something. It goes directly to the post office, and then directly out to Q. All right, so keep that picture in mind. To get from P to Q, you have to come into the center and then go out. Okay, this is how you get from one point to another. We can give a formula for this. There's our formula. It looks a little complicated, but this is just saying find the distance from P to the origin plus the distance from Q to the origin. And if you're sending a letter to yourself, you don't need to use the post office system. So the distance from P to Q, if P equals Q, is just 0. You don't need to get involved. All right, so does everyone feel they can know how to get from one point to the other in this distance function? I hope so. So now I'm going to give you another exercise. Here's a point, P equals 4, 3. I'd like you to find the circles of radius 3, 5, 6, and 10. Centered at this point. So let's kind of talk through one of them together. So you can imagine you have a letter, and you put just enough postage for your letter to travel a distance of 3. Who can you send a letter to? Nobody. Someone said nobody, and you're correct. This is that another trick question, kind of like the one you were talking about. Because you can't even get to the post office in distance 3, right? So you can't send a letter to anybody. So this circle, in this case, will be empty. No points at all. Okay, now you've gotten a little push, a little head start, and now try to figure out 5, 6, and 10 yourself in the next few minutes on your own or with your neighbor, even better. Okay, let's pool all of our results together. So far we already talked about what happens when radius is 3. We can't even get to the post office, so the circle is nothing. There's nothing to color in. It's an empty set. All right, but how do things work when the radius is 5? Who can we send letters to? Anyone? The post office. Yeah, you can reach the post office, but you've already used up all your postage there, so you can talk to the post office. So this dot here is a circle centered at P of radius 5. Good job. Okay, what about radius 6? What will that circle look like? Anyone shout it out? Say again? Yeah, a Euclidean circle centered at the origin of radius 1. That's what, unit circle, that's what you said, yeah. So you can get to the post office. You've already used up distance 5, so you still have distance 1 left, so you can travel around a distance of 1. So that is a circle of radius 6 centered at P. All right, now we move up to 10. How does this one work out? Is there anything different about this one than the last one, or is it exactly the same? Yes, someone said P is not on the circle. Very good. So if I just went like before, I use up distance 5 just to get to the origin. I still have distance 5 left, so I would get this circle, Euclidean circle of radius 5 centered at the origin. But P itself, how far is P from itself? 0. It's not a distance 10 from itself, so he doesn't belong in the circle, so you cut it out. So this is a circle of radius 10 centered at P. Okay, now we've reached the extra credit part of the lecture, where we think about what's the circumference of this circle. And the reason I make it extra credit is it might be a little overwhelming. It's not quite as routine. It looks friendly enough, right? This looks kind of like a Euclidean circle, so it seems like the circumference should be something normal, but it's not. It would be normal and friendly if we were measuring distance using Euclidean distance, but we have to imagine a post office worker visiting all these points along the circle. And how does the post office worker travel? He needs to go in and out, in and out, in and out. So what is the length of his path going to be? It's going to be infinite, yeah. So the circumference doesn't work out in this case either. So I've just handed you two distance functions, neither of which worked out nearly as well as the first two that I handed you. But that's good, because now we see that our expectations were a little high. We thought that there'd be this nice flow chart. You start with a distance function, it gives you circles, and then we get a value for pi, and now we've got to amend that, and that's a good thing, that you can't just start off with any distance function. It's got to be a good one, okay? Not everybody works. So I'm going to tell you exactly what the rules are to be a good distance function. Mathematicians have figured this out. And some of the rules you'll say, of course, I would never think of breaking that rule. But we just want to make sure we list everything so that no one tries to get anything past us. So the first rule is that your distance function must be positive definite. What that means is you cannot say the distance between two points is a negative number that's out of bounds. Okay, that's an example of something that you probably wouldn't ever do. So we have to say this value, the distance between two points, P and Q, must be non-negative. It could be 0. The only time it can be 0 is if the two points are the same. And other than that, it has to be positive. The next requirement of being a good distance function is that it must be symmetric. That means that if you measured the distance from P to Q, whatever you decide that should be, right? There's freedom there. But the distance back from Q back to P needs to be the same number. You can't be so creative that the distance in one direction is different than the distance back. Okay, that's the second. Next one is called the triangle inequality. It's a really famous requirement, and I often call it the ice cream rule for the following reason. So we have two points, P and Q, and just to help you bring it down to earth, let's imagine P is here we are all at the talk, and then after the talk, you're going to go home. And you could, after the talk, just go directly home. That's fine. But there's always an option that you could stop off for ice cream on the way home. So there's two possible paths to your home, going directly there or stopping off for ice cream. So if you stop off for ice cream, what will that likely do to the length of your trip home? It'll likely make it bigger. So that's what triangle inequality says, is that if you stop off for ice cream on the way home, it'll make your path grow in length. It's possible it could be equal in length. What would make that happen? You could live at the ice cream shop, then it would be equal, or the ice cream shop could be directly on your way home, right? So here's the triangle inequality in mathematical language, that the distance between P and Q, MoMath and home, is less than or equal to the distance between going from MoMath to ice cream and then ice cream to home. All right. Next requirement to be a good distance function is it must be translation invariant. So that means if you take two points and you translate them both, so they both move with the same motion to two new points, P prime and Q prime, the distance before and after translation must be the same. So distance between P and Q must be the same as P prime and Q prime. Now we're ready for the final requirement on what it means to be a good distance function. And it's the most subtle, not quite as easy. It says if you take two points P and Q and you do a scalar multiple of both of them, so multiply both of them by some scalar, we'll call it R, you end up with RP and RQ. So it just dilates them out or shrinks them in. And this requirement says that the distance between RP and RQ is just equal to R times the distance between P and Q. That one's a little harder, but it's necessary. All right, so here's the list. Here's the list of all those five requirements. And remember, the post office distance was not a good distance function. So that means the post office distance failed one of these requirements. Can anyone take a moment and maybe take a guess of which one did the post office distance fail? It definitely fails 4. If you take two points and translate them both up, did they just stay the same distance apart? No, it went up. They're now even further from the post office, so it takes even further to get from one point to the other. So it's not translation invariant. Fails 4. It passes 5. The discrete distance function fails one of these as well. The teleportation one. It fails 5. Yes. It actually passes all 1, 2, 3, and 4. You can think through them, why it passes all the first ones and fails 5. Okay, so we're gonna forget about the bad ones. No more, like erase the post office distance from your head for now. And we just wanna focus on good ones that make this beautiful geometry happen. And good distance functions have a mathematical term. They're known as norms on the plane. So we'd like to find a few more norms on the plane. So far we just have 2, the Euclidean distance function and taxicab distance. We'd like a few more. If I asked you to come up with a few more, this is how you would feel. You'd feel like this guy trying blindfolded and groping about to try to find another norm. It feels impossible. Why does it feel impossible? Because you're trying to come up with a function that satisfies 5 different requirements all at once. It doesn't seem like it's going to happen. So I'm going to get you started and introduce you to your first family of norms. It's a very famous family. And the 2 norms we've already met, they are 2 members of this infinite family. So here's Euclidean distance, its formula here. And here's taxicab distance, and here's its formula here. And here's my plan. I'm going to rewrite this distance equation in a way such that it mirrors this one up here. Not gonna change it, just rewrite it in a different way. So I'm gonna erase and rewrite it this way. Still the taxicab distance formula, but do you see now how it looks really similar to this one? And you can see now how you could generalize to think of a next distance function that would fit in this lineup. Hopefully you can. And these are called the LP norms. So instead of 1s and 2s, we put any number p, where p is any number greater than or equal to 1. So p can be 2, 3, 4, 5. It can even be non-integer values like 6.8 or pi. It can be any number you'd like. And so now we have infinitely many good distance functions or norms. And now we want to see what the unit circles look like for LP norms. So here's the unit circle when p equals 1. It's the taxicab unit circle, those diamonds we constructed before. And now I'm going to let p increase, because it's supposed to start at 1 and be any number bigger. So we're going to let p increase and see what happens to the unit circle. And you'll see that they'll bow out. Right now it's really nice and tight. They'll bow out. So here's p equals 1.2, p equals 1.5. Here's p equals 2. That's a Euclidean, beautiful Euclidean circle. And then p equals 3, p equals 5, p equals 10. And you can see that they're limiting. If you take the limit as p goes to infinity, you get the unit square. So that's what, these are a whole bunch of new circles with different norms. Now we can figure out what the pi values are associated to them. So here's the theorem for that. This is a theorem of Adler and Tanton. Many people proved this independently, but this is just written up very nicely and kind of recently, so I'm quoting them. They said, let pi sub p denote the pi value associated to the LP norm. Then pi sub p, that pi value, is in this interval between our usual value of pi and 4. Let's just look at the picture. The pi values of the LP norms fill in this interval between our usual value of pi, sweeping out all of these values all the way up to 4. Rational, irrational, everything is swept out by the LP norms. Okay. So we just now added infinitely many values that pi can be. Sometimes pi equals 4, but sometimes pi equals 3.5, right? Or sometimes pi equals 3.888. All of those things. And you could ask, like, pick your favorite number in here, say 3.5. Say, how many LP norms have that value as their pi value? The answer is exactly 2. And here's the theorem for that. It's a theorem of Keller and Vakil in 2009. They said that two pi values are equal for two LP norms if and only if 1 over p plus 1 over q equals 1. So, for example, the L3 norm and the L3 halves norm, they both have the same pi value. That's because 1 over 3 plus 1 over 3 halves equals 1. All right. So far, what we've done is great. But to be honest, we've only figured out how things work for a very small subset of all the norms on the plane. We have a whole lot of more norms to tackle. And if we had to keep going in the same way, like coming up with formulas, then drawing the circles, then computing the value of pi, then we would all kind of lose heart because it's not so interesting. But this is an exciting and amazing part of the talk, that we don't have to continue this way. We can push it all away and solve this entire problem geometrically. And I'll explain exactly what I mean. So far, this is the struggling part of our existence so far. We've been coming up with a formula. We work really hard. Then we draw the unit circle and compute the value of pi. But we're going to turn the tables around and say, you come up with what you want the unit circle to look like. Just draw something. As long as it satisfies 3 geometric requirements, then that's fine. That will uniquely determine a norm. They're in one-to-one correspondence. Okay, so instead of banging your head against a wall finding a formula that satisfies 5 requirements, you could just draw a picture of how you want your unit circles to be, satisfying 3 visual guidelines, and then you're in business. Okay, so no more of this. We're going to work this way. We want to find good unit circles. They'll uniquely define a norm, and we'll have a pi value as well. Okay, so what are those 3 requirements on unit circles that make them good? The first requirement is it must enclose a finite area and include a neighborhood of the origin. So you can't draw a unit circle that goes off for forever like the discrete metric. That's not okay. And the second requirement is if you connect any 2 points in the shape with a straight line, the line must stay inside the shape. There's a math word for this, and it's called convexity. That's what this is exactly what it means. And the third requirement is that the shape should be symmetric under 180 degree rotation. So if I take the shape and rotate it 180 degrees, it should look as if you hadn't done a thing. It rotates right back into itself with a 180 degree turn. Okay, so if out there are a few of you that said, I would really love it if we could find a distance function where the unit circle looks like hearts, wouldn't that be cool? Your heart is broken now because you now realize it will never happen. Which of these things does it fail? Which of these requirements does it fail? It fails two and three. So it fails two because here's two points on the heart, and if you connect them with the line does not stay inside the heart. So it fails two, and it also fails three. If I took this and did a 180 degree turn, it would be an upside down heart. It would no longer look like a heart. Okay, there's another shape that we have to lay aside, and that's a triangle. What does it fail? It fails three. So it actually is fine. It is a convex shape. These are totally fine, but it fails three because if you rotate it around, it's now upside down. It doesn't look the same. All right, but never fear. There are lots of shapes that do fit these requirements. Here's a bunch of them. I just put a bunch, but you could come up with many, 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 many more. And I have two things left to describe to you. Given a shape like this, how does it uniquely determine a norm? And what sorts of pi values show up? All right, so first we'll describe how do you determine a norm from this. If you can keep your bearings about you, I know you've been through a lot so far in this talk, but just because you decide what a unit circle looks like, how does that tell you the distance between points? That's what a norm is, telling you the distance. So we're gonna do it with this example. Let's say I want my unit circle to look like this shape. How would that determine the distance between two points? So there's my beautiful unit circle. Doesn't it look great? And here's two points, P and Q. How could I determine how far apart they are? So there's a process. And it's just a three-step process, and I'll just describe it all in one slide here for you. The first step is to take the two points and find P minus Q. That will be another point on the plane. And in this case, there's P minus Q. And the next step, you draw a ray from the origin through P minus Q. There it is. And that ray will cut through the unit circle in a single point, and we'll call that point U for unit circle. Now let's look. Do you see U and P minus Q? They are multiples of each other. If I just stretch U out, it would equal P minus Q. So what you need to do is find out what do I need to multiply U by to get to P minus Q? Call that scalar multiple R. And R is how we define the distance between the two points. P and Q are distance R from each other, where R is the scalar multiple we need to make U equal to P minus Q. All right, check that off. There is a way to start with a unit circle and define a distance function. Now we get to the other side of the story. What are the possible pi values that you can get from this game? So here's a number line, and let's review our progress. So far we've observed that pi can equal our usual value, 3.14159, and pi can equal 4 if we take the taxi cab distance. And with LP norms, it can fill in all the numbers between those two red dots. So I'd like us to think about what other numbers do you think will be possible? How high do you think pi can go? How low do you think pi can go? So I'll give you a hint. We have still infinitely many pi values to find. So this isn't all of them. And I think it's good if you can invest a little bit in this experience. So I'd like you to make a conjecture of how low and how high you think pi can go. And there's no pressure because you've never heard of this before. So you're just taking a wild guess. But I think you should tell your neighbor what your guesses are right now. So take 1 second and do that. Okay, so I'd love to hear some people's conjectures of how low do you think pi can go? Anybody provide their conjecture? Yes? Between 3 and 154 is low to high. All right, thank you. Any other conjectures? Does anyone think we can get a higher than 4? All right, here's the answer. We're ready. So the lowest pi can go is 3. You were correct. And the highest pi can go is 4. That was the ceiling. And not only that, pi is equal to 3 if and only if you choose as your unit circle an affine regular hexagon. If you choose another shape, it won't be 3. And pi is equal to 4 if and only if you choose as your unit circle a parallelogram, which worked out with our taxicab circles, right? They were parallelograms, and our pi value was 4, right? And if you choose any other shape for your unit circle, you'll be some value in between. Okay? All right, so let's put this in a nice formal theorem so it looks, it's completely clear and official. If D is any norm on the plane, the pi value is stuck in between the interval 3 and 4. This is proved by a Polish mathematician in 1932. And then we have another proof, or another statement, that the pi value is 3 if and only if the unit circle is an affine regular hexagon. Regular hexagon means all the sides are equal length. And then affine means you can dilate, rotate, or shear the hexagon, and that's okay. And the pi value is 4 if and only if the unit circle is a parallelogram. And then finally, we say that every number between 3 and 4, pick any number you like between 3 and 4, and there is a norm such that the pi value is that number. Okay. Now, these are pretty strong statements if you think about it. So I'm guaranteeing that if you go home and come up with your own nice distance function, no matter what you do, you're so constrained, your pi value will not get outside this interval. How could I make such a bold claim that I know, no matter what you do, your pi value will be between 3 and 4? I'm going to outline how that can be true for you so that you have some intuition. So let's say you go home and you decide this will be your unit circle. It passes all three rules, right? How can I show that, oh, actually, your pi value is between 3 and 4? So here's what you do. The first step is you circumscribe around that unit circle a parallelogram whose perimeter is 8. Now, I'm not telling you how to do that. I'm just saying that's the first step and it can be done. And then you inscribe into your unit circle a hexagon whose perimeter is 6. And this wedges in the perimeter of your unit circle. Your unit circle has to have perimeter between 6 and 8, right? I've wedged it in between two shapes. And now if I just divide all sides of this inequality by 2, I see that your pi value is between 3 and 4. Okay, so that's definitely, I jumped over how to make this blue parallelogram and how to make this green hexagon, but that's the main idea of how it gets done. Okay, back to our theorem. I also think that everyone in here can get on board with why this last statement is true. Pick any number between 3 and 4. How can you be sure that there's not like a skip in the numbers of pi? Like maybe 3.9 is not possible or something like that. So it all comes from this shape here. How many sides does this shape have? It's a hexagon, right? And it's actually an affine regular hexagon, so its pi value is 3. And watch how it morphs when I click through. It morphs into a parallelogram. Okay, so we can go back and forth, and it can morph smoothly from one to the other. So what we do is when we start with the hexagon, its pi value is 3. And as it morphs, the pi value sweeps out all the way from 3, and when we get to the parallelogram, we know the pi value must be 4, because we know that if you have a parallelogram, its pi value is 4. So this diagram shows you can sweep through all possible values of pi. All right, now I want to give you a big picture of what just happened. I've just been slowly, ploddingly introducing you to this new world of math for many of us called finite dimensional normed linear spaces. And in particular, you and I have been talking about two-dimensional normed linear spaces. You can go into higher dimensions if you would like. And I also want to just highlight for you that this should help you see that math is much more vast than we can ever express. You spent a whole year of high school studying Euclidean geometry, maybe. But Euclidean geometry is just one geometry out of infinitely many possibilities. So math is quite vast. And I also want to give you some next steps. So if this was your very first time hearing about this topic and you'd like to learn more, this is a very friendly book. It's a paperback, short, friendly introduction to just taxicab distance. It doesn't move on beyond that. And it has lots of fun exercises and things to think about. Once you're feeling good here, if you want to be more general, this is there's an article in Math Horizons that I wrote called A Pi Day of the Century every year. And you can check that out. It's at maybe at the college level. And then this is a textbook that would be at the graduate level for this sort of thing. And it goes into higher dimensions as well. All right. So now I want to end with some comments. First of all, you remember at the beginning of the talk I said how we celebrate Pi Day. But now with our new perspective on the possible values of pi, I just want to point out that there aren't enough days in the month of March to celebrate all the possible values of pi. So you should just continue celebrating the entire month long. There's no problem. And also remember how we felt a little shocked when Professor Frink said pi is exactly 3. But now with our new perspective, we're not quite as shocked. It's possible pi could be exactly 3. All right, thank you very much for listening.
All right, if anybody has any questions, I will bring the microphone to you. You can raise your hand.
What can I calculate in the physical world that would be helpful to me with this abstraction?
With this abstraction. Abstraction, okay, yeah. So in the physical world, maybe not so much, but you can consider data. So the easy example I could give is, let's make a vector. And in the vector, for me and one for you, in the vector I have how I rated all my Netflix views that I watched. All the movies I've watched, I have a vector, and in it is my numerical rating. And then you have a vector. How far apart are your tastes than mine? Is Euclidean distance a good way to measure how far apart they are? Or is there something different? So it turns out that mathematicians, data scientists who study this, they realize that sometimes Euclidean distance isn't the best way. Because maybe the difference between your preferences and mine aren't so necessarily well measured by certain movies, and other movies are more important. So they use other LP norms, actually. To measure distance between data points. So it's not a physical world thing, but it's a real world thing.
Hey, I know you covered a lot of norms, but you said everything, these norms are on a plane. So does this cover elliptic surfaces and hyperbolic surfaces as well? Or if the circle was on an elliptic surface?
Does it cover elliptic surfaces?
Yeah.
So in general, these are geometries that you put on Rn, and so it is not considered on elliptic surfaces. It's considered on Euclidean space, and you put different norms on Euclidean space.
Thank you very much. This is the best talk I've heard in MoMath, and I've go to all of them. But oh. So is pi changing have anything to do with time being relative?
No.
Okay.
Teleportation, yeah. Or at least I can't comment on that. Maybe that's a better response. I cannot comment myself, but it's a great question.
So let's give a hand again.
Thank you.